Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. My name's Ray and I'll be studying Physical and Natural Sciences at the University of Cambridge. And as you can expect from the title, I got an A star in A level physics and I'll be going through how. So just for context, I did AQA physics and I did the astrophysics option as well, but I'm sure much of this advice will be applicable to other exam boards as well. So I'll be going through the resources I used one by one whilst giving any examples when necessary of how I use them. A link to any other websites I mentioned will be down in the description below. So number one, use the specification. A lot of people don't end up using the specification for subjects like physics compared to subjects like biology because they think there isn't much in it, but it still can be really valuable. So I would suggest downloading the specification and either printing it out, or if you don't want to print it out, upload it to somewhere like Google Drive or OneNote, and on your computer or tablet you can annotate the specification. And as you're going through the specification and through your course, just make sure you're covering all the key points, because you don't want to be in the exam situation where you haven't covered a small area of the specification and then it ends up being a 3 or a 4 mark question which can end up costing you a whole grade. Ask for clarification from your teachers if there's something you don't understand from the spec, because it's their job to know inside out. But of course you can still use it as well, even if it's their job. For me personally, I use the specification several times throughout the year as I was going along, like every month or two. I checked to make sure I had covered everything up to that point, and then closer to the exams I checked it more frequently and frequently just to make sure, and any points which I hadn't covered I'd either go to a textbook, go to a teacher, or search online and see what I actually have to cover for that point. So number two, use flashcards. So a lot of people don't end up using flashcards for physics because they think it's not too content heavy that it's worth them using flashcards, but there are still definitely things you have to memorize, and you can even like distill concepts down onto flashcards, and rather than memorizing the other side word for word, you use it as a trigger for you recalling the concept and explaining it into your own words. So if you're doing A2 physics, you can make yourself explain Lenz's law, and or just remember the definition for Lenz's law from the specification, but also make sure you understand it when you're going through the flashcard. So I made my flashcards loosely based on a method called the Cornell method, and in that I had two columns, the smaller column being for questions and the second column being for answers or definitions and concepts or whatever you want. So I'll go through how I made them later, but be sure to make your own, because at least 50% of the learning comes from making the flashcards, and as you're making them you're understanding the concepts better and better, whereas if you're using someone else's flashcards then you won't understand the concepts as well, or you won't have it in your own words, and then you'll just effectively be memorizing, which won't be so good when it comes to an application question on your exam. So the reason I made flashcards on a computer instead of on paper for physics is because I found it much easier to be able to edit the flashcards or add images and stuff like that, because you can just find a Feynman diagram or some other image off Google and just drag and drop into your flashcard. And if you find a mistake later on, you can just edit it on your phone or computer, and you don't have to worry about making it look nice or pretty or something, and you can get down to revising more using the flashcards and reviewing them more rather than making them look nice. Ultimately, it saved me a lot of time and I'd highly recommend trying it out. So then I copied my flashcards over to an app called Anki onto my computer and then synced it onto my phone. If you don't know what Anki is, I'd highly suggest googling it or finding videos online, because the small amount of time it takes you to get used to Anki and learn how to use it will pay off massively in terms of revision, because it makes sure your revision is more effective and based on solely the areas which you need to work on. I've used Anki for the past 4 years now almost, so I plan on making a video series soon on how to use it and how to get the most out of it. If it's out, it should be linked up somewhere by now. Otherwise, just wait. So I went through my flashcards every day on both my phone and my computer for months. it's really not as much as it seems, because some days you might only have 20 or 30 flashcards to go through, and other days only 5 or 10. But when you're starting out, you're going to have to go through a lot, because Anki needs to know which ones you're struggling on and which ones you're not. So the ones which you're struggling on come up more frequently than the other ones, and it makes sure your revision time is the most effective. If you were doing it on paper, you'd just be going through all of them in a pile, like one after the other, even the ones you're stronger on. Whereas with Anki, you're going through the weaker ones more frequently than the stronger ones. So it's really personalized to your revision. The best part with it is that you can be as strict as you want on how you remember the card. So if it's a definition which you're memorizing from a mark scheme, because some exam boards can be a bit picky, you can say, if I don't get this word for word, I'm not going to mark it as right. Whereas if it's for a concept, you might give yourself some leeway in explaining it in terms of your own words, just so you can remember it again. The most important thing to remember is to not worry too much if it's taking you too long to recall what's on the other side of the flashcard, especially when you're starting out, because the more effort you're putting into remembering what's on the other side, or the definition and concept, the stronger your synapse connections become in your brain, and the easier it'll be to remember what's on the other side the next time, and the time after, and so on. It just becomes easier over time. It's all part of a learning process. But when you're doing it, just make sure to verbalize the answer to yourself, like whisper the answer quietly to yourself, because it stops you from kidding yourself that you've got it right. Because at least when I was doing flashcards 4 years ago, I'd say the answer in my head and then flip over and say, oh, that was right, even though it wasn't really right. So I'd highly recommend doing that, and it makes sure your revision is as effective as it could be. So now I'll be going through what I used to make my flashcards. So the first thing I'd used to make my flashcards were my class notes, and they were like the backbone, the fundamentals, or the starting point of my flashcards. So every weekend what I'd do, I'd type up my class notes onto my computer and slowly turn on them into flashcards, whilst adding to them and making sure they're complete using other resources, as I'll go on to mention. So then I'd go on to use CGP revision guides to add onto my flashcards, and I use them to make sure that I had covered everything up to that point. And if there were any diagrams that I liked from the books, I'd take a picture using my phone and then move it onto my computer, rather than like drawing nice diagrams at myself. They're not quite as good as the videos, which I'll talk about later. So the next thing I'd go on to use is a website called Fizzbot, and Fizzbot has really good images, explanations, and notes to help you add onto your flashcards. And as you're reading it, just make sure you're understanding it all, and then you can either rewrite it in your own words or use some of the words and phrases they've been using. And for any equations which you want, you can just copy and paste it onto your flashcards from there. So the main thing I used was YouTube, because I don't learn as well from books as other people do, and just seeing someone go through the concepts makes it stick so much better. Unlike subjects like chemistry and biology, where you want to find videos more related to your spec, for physics, it's more about understanding, and you can find videos from almost any YouTuber who doesn't make A-level specific content. So some of the ones I ended up using were Khan Academy and someone called Duck Schuster, and just their videos relevant to the small topics. So if you didn't understand Young's double slit, you can just search that onto YouTube, and you'd find a video by Khan Academy, and the guy would go through and explain Young's double slit slowly and in a way for you to understand. And I think the level of videos that they end up making are better than some of the ones that A-level YouTubers end up making, but that doesn't mean you can't use those ones as well. As for those who stick closely to the A-level content, you have Burroughs Physics and Science Shorts and A-Level Science Online. They were all quite good, especially Science Shorts, because he was really quick and straight to the point, and he has videos going through some past papers as well, which I'll move on to later. But ultimately, all these videos and YouTubers helps me contribute to my flashcards. So after I understood a topic, I'd end up making a flashcard about it and explain it in my own words. So when I'm going free on Anki, like every day or something, or however often it shows up, then I would explain it in my own words, and I'd be remembering concepts throughout the year. So I also ended up using the textbook a bit. I went through it just to make sure I more or less knew everything, but it does go into some waffle here and there, which you don't really need to know. But the best thing about the textbook is it has a whole section towards your applied module if you're doing AQA or some other exam board. So because there wasn't much content on astrophysics, we had to either Google it or we could find a whole textbook chapter about it, and that was really useful for the applied module and applied exam. I'm not quite sure how it works on other exam boards, but if it's something similar, I'd suggest going to a textbook for the applied stuff, because you won't find many other resources online. So the next resource I used was Physics Maths Tutor. While I do think the website is a bit overrated in some ways, it definitely has a good collection of topic tests and past papers, which you won't find in many other places unless your school gives them to you as well. So using the topic tests throughout year 12 and year 13, I'd go through them and make sure I understand what's what I'm learning as I'm going along, because you don't want to start understanding a lot of the material like 1 or 2 months before the exam, because it really piles up at that point, and you want to be revising it at that point rather than understanding it for the first time. So then there's Isaac Physics. While the website can be a bit annoying at times, it can really help you improve your math skills in physics if that's what you're struggling on the most. For me, that was fine, but so I didn't have to use it as much, but I know it can be really helpful to some people, especially if you want to tackle the harder A-star level calculations for physics. So the final and most important thing I used were past papers. I don't think anyone's gotten an A-star in physics without using at least some past papers, because the content can only get you so far. Personally, for me, I went through every single one, including the old spec. While it can be a bit repetitive, the old spec questions, I just sort of like flicked through the ones which I thought were really obvious, but the new spec ones are really useful. So as I was going through them, I'd add my score onto a past paper tracker, and then any which had quite low scores, I'd end up going through again towards like closer to the exam time. So I'd have an overview of how I was doing across the years and stuff like that. I would suggest being strict on timing, and when you finish a paper, of course you're going to have to learn some stuff from the past paper, because there's no point doing it otherwise. So I would have a mistakes document, or a new content mistakes document. So after the paper, I'd go through all the questions after having marked it and see what else I could add to my flashcards. So if there's any wording I can improve that's better suited to the mark scheme, or if there's any common mistakes I make, I'd add them all onto a document, and then before exams and before the actual test and before topic tests and stuff like that, I'd read through the relevant part of the document just to make sure I don't make those mistakes in the exam by reminding myself of the ones I usually make. This is going to vary from person to person, and I would suggest doing past papers consistently as exam time approaches, because doing 3 or 4 papers throughout the week is going to be a lot more beneficial than doing 3 or 4 at the weekend. But don't let the papers pile up throughout the week, because you don't want to mark it a few days later and look at a question you got wrong and wonder why you thought that at the time. It's better to mark the paper as soon as you've done it to maximize the amount of benefit you're getting from the paper. After using the mark scheme, if you're still confused on a few questions, you can usually search the paper up on YouTube, and you have someone like Science Shorts who goes through the new spec AQA at Excel papers. And if there's nothing like that and you're still stuck on a question, you can go onto somewhere like the student room, or you can go to your teacher and ask them for help. But just definitely do it, because you don't want to make the same mistake over and over. Because if you don't deal with it now, who knows, it might come up in the exam. So that's all for now. I hope it goes well for your exam. Good luck with physics. While I can't guarantee you an A star by following all this advice, you should have a pretty good shot at getting one. It all comes down to the amount of effort and hard work you're willing to put in. So I made some other how I got an A star videos for maths, Fev maths and chemistry. If you want to see them, they're linked down below. And if you want to see my physics flashcards, they should be linked down below as part of a video or something. If you have any suggestions for any videos I should make, leave a comment down below. If you like the video, then please give a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel. I'm planning on making more videos like this soon and on studying exam technique and stuff like that. So stay tuned and thanks for watching.